Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. As you have already seen the title, this video is the start of a new series on the UART peripheral. I have covered a lot of videos on the UART in the past few years, but none of them were very detailed, and also they were very random. The purpose of the series is to give you enough information on the peripheral, and in an organized manner. I will use the STM32F4 series controller for this series, as the UART peripheral in it is not very complicated, and it has enough features. I will also cover more sophisticated features used on the higher-end MCUs like the Cortex-M7 series, but later in the series. In today's video we will see how to connect devices, how to configure the UART, and how to send data via the UART. We will also understand the parameters used in the configuration. If we want to send and receive the data from a computer using the UART, we need to use a USB to TTL converter module. The module converts the USB signal to TTL level, and hence can be used with a microcontroller. This is how the connection should be made with the module. Here for demonstration, I am using the FT232 USB to UART module. The TX pin from the MCU connects to the RX pin of the module, and the RX pin from the MCU connects to the TX pin of the module. The UART connection is always made in the cross, connecting the TX pin with the RX and RX pin with the TX. This is how the connection should be made with another device. As I mentioned, the TX pin of the first device connects with the RX pin of the second device, and vice versa. If you own a Nucleo or a Discovery board from ST, you might not need the additional module to communicate with the computer. Some of these devices have the feature called Virtual COM port, where the USB used for the SD link can also be used to communicate with the computer. Here is the schematics for the Nucleo F446RE development board from ST. Scroll down to the SD link section. Generally, ST uses the F103C8 MCU for the SD link. The SD link TX pin is connected to the pin PA2 of the SD link, and the SD link RX is connected to the pin PA3 of the SD link. These SD link pins are connected to the Nucleo board in a cross connection, and the SD link USB can act as the virtual COM port. Actually, this one is not that well documented. We will see another schematics in a while. As I mentioned, some of the Discovery and Nucleo boards do support the virtual COM port, but not all of them support it. Here is another schematic of the STM32F4 Discovery board. Here in the SD link section, you can see that there are no TX and RX pins connected to the SD link. Which simply means that the UART virtual COM port is not available with this Discovery board. But this certainly does not mean that all Discovery boards do not support the virtual COM port. Here I have another schematic of the STM32F412 Discovery board. And in the SD link section you can see the virtual COM port. This one is relatively a new development board from ST, and it is documented pretty well. The USART2 TX pin is connected to the SD-Link RX, and the USART2 RX is connected to the SD-Link TX. To transfer the data via the virtual COM port, we need to use the USART2. Here in the MCU section you can see the USART2 pins are actually the pins PA2 and PA3. I am using the Nucleo F446RE development board, and it does support the virtual COM port. I am going to use this serial software to communicate with the board. Here you can see right now there are only two ports available. Now I am connecting the Nucleo board to the computer. Here it popped up as a storage device. And here you can see an extra port available. This is the virtual COM port created by the Nucleo board, and we can use this port to send data to the board via the UART. So if you own a Nucleo or Discovery board, it might or might not support the virtual COM port. You can check the schematic of the board in the ST's website itself. After opening the board's page, go to the CAD resource tab. Here you can see the schematic for the respective board. So I guess this is enough information on the connection between the computer and the board. Let's start the Cube IDE and create a new project. As I mentioned, I am using the Nucleo F446RE development board. Give some name to the project, and click Finish. Let's start with the clock setup. Here I am enabling the high-speed external crystal to provide the clock to the MCU. The board has 8 MHz crystal on it, and we will run the system at maximum 180 MHz. Go to Sys, Debug, and enable Serial Wire. Now go to the Connectivity tab, and here you can see a lot of UART instances are available on this board. Note that some of them are named as UART, and the rest are named as USART. UART stands for Universal Asynchronous Receiver and Transmitter, whereas the USART is Universal Synchronous Asynchronous Receiver and Transmitter. Basically, the UART is only capable of asynchronous transmission, whereas the USART supports both synchronous and asynchronous. Other than asynchronous mode, the UART also supports half-duplex mode, the multiprocessor communication, the IRDA, and LIN protocols. All these modes and protocols do not require the synchronizing clock. Whereas the USART supports all the UART features, and also the synchronous mode along with the smart card communication. These modes require a synchronizing clock, and hence they are supported only by USART. In today's video, we will use the asynchronous mode for communicating with the computer. I am using USART 2 because it is connected to the virtual COM port, and hence I do not need to connect any additional hardware to transfer the data. Let's check the parameter settings now. The baud rate of the transmitter and receiver must be the same in order to receive the correct data transmitted. Here I am keeping it at 115200, and later we will set the same rate for the receiver also. The word length includes the data bits, and the parity bit. The parity bit can be used to check for the errors while transmission. Here the picture shows a general UART frame. We have the details for different word lengths. The UART frame consists of the start bit, followed by the 8 data bits, which may or may not include the parity, and finally the stop bit. We can use half stop bits, or 1, or 1.5, or even 2 stop bits. We can use different word lengths depending on the requirement of the transmission. I am going to use the 8-bit word length. There will be no parity bit, and the stop bit will be 1. Note here that we don't have all the options shown in the picture. This may vary depending on the microcontroller you are using. The data direction will be receive and transmit, as we want to do both. Now comes the oversampling. Oversampling is used to increase the receiver's tolerance for the clock deviation. Basically, if there is some deviation during the transmission, which may arise due to some fluctuation in the baud rate, the oversampling is used to get the correct data. Oversampling of 16 means that each serial bit is sampled 16 times, and hence increases the accuracy. But it also reduces the maximum baud rate of the receiver as shown in this picture. So there is a trade-off between the maximum baud rate support and the accuracy of the data received. I will leave it to 16, as I am not using a very high baud rate. You can see the pin PA2 is configured as the TX pin, and the pin PA3 is configured as the RX pin. If you are using a converter module, or another MCU as the receiver, you need to connect these pins in cross-connection. I am using the virtual COM port of the SD-Link, so these pins are already connected in cross to the respective pins of the SD-Link. That is all we need to configure. Let's generate the project now. Here is our main file. Let's define a data buffer that we will send via the UART. The slash n is used for the new line, so the next data will be printed on a new line in the console. Here in the main function, UART is pre-initialized by the generated code, so we will simply transmit the data. Let's write the code in the while loop. Here we will call the function holUARTTransmit. The parameters are the UART instance, UART2 in our case, the data pointer, the buffer we defined above, the size of the data in bytes, so 12 in our case, and the timeout. The function will time out in 1 second if the data is not transmitted. Let's give a delay of 1 second between each call to this function. Alright, we do not have any errors, so let's flash the program to the board. Let's open the serial terminal now. We need to use the same configuration that we used for the UART. So the baud rate will be 115200, there are 8 data bits with no parity, and 1 stop bit. Let's open the port now. Here you can see the data is being received in the console, and it is receiving every 1 second. This is exactly how we programmed it on the MCU. So our code is working fine so far. Let's try to send a number via the UART. This shouldn't be an array here. We need to pass the address here, and let's change the size to 2 bytes. Alright, let's flash it to the board now. Here you can see that we are not quite receiving the number 123. Instead, we are receiving the curly brackets. But in reality, we are receiving the correct data. To understand it, let's check the ASCII table. Here you can see the character defined for the number 123 is the same as what we received via teachUART. The UART transfers the data in the ASCII format, so we need to pass the data to it in the similar form. If we want to transmit any number, it must be first converted to the ASCII character form. Let's define an array to store the ASCII character form of the number. The number of bytes in the array should at least be equal to the number of digits. Now we will use the sprintf function to do the conversion. The format specifier, d, is used because we are converting an integer here. The converted characters will be stored in the number array, so we will send the array to the UART. We need to include the standard I/O header file for the sprintf to work. We still have a warning, and that is because the sprintf takes the character pointer as the parameter. You can typecase it here, but anyway it won't change anything. Alright, let's flash the program to the board. Now we are receiving the numbers on the console. So everything works as expected. We were able to transmit the data via the UART, and receive it on the serial console on the computer. In the next video, we will see how to use the interrupt and DMA to do the same. Then we will move towards the receiving part, which is comparatively harder. This is it for the video. I hope everything was clear. You can download the code from the link in the description. Leave comments in case of any doubt. Keep watching, and have a nice day ahead.